So, this is kind of cringy, but today I'm going to be filming an ASMR. I'm going to be reading probably like two chapters from my favorite book, The Song of Achilles by Madeline Miller. And I don't have a real microphone, so yes, I'm literally using Apple headphones that aren't even mine because mine are broken. But this is called ASMR on a budget. So, yeah, I'm just gonna jump right into it. Also, yes, my hair is brown now. So, that's cool. Chapter 12. I woke to the red of my eyelids straining out the sun. I was cold. My right shoulder exposed to the breezes of the window, the one that faced the sea. The space beside me on the bed was empty. But the pillow still held the shape of him, and the sheets smelled of us both. I had spent so many mornings alone in this room. As he visited his mother, I did not think it was strange to find him gone. My eyes closed, and I sank again into the trailing thoughts of dreams. Time passed, and the sun came hot over the windowsill. The birds were up, and the servants, and even the men. I heard their voices from the beach and the practice hall, the rattle and bang of chores. I sat up. His sandals were overturned beside the bed, forgotten. It was not unusual. He went barefoot most places. He had gone to breakfast, I guessed. He was letting me sleep. Half of me wanted to stay in the room until his return, but that was cowardice. I had a right to a place by his side now. And I would not let the eyes of the servant drive me away. I pulled on my tunic and left to find him. He was not in the great hall, busy with servants removing the same platters and bowls there had always been. He was not in Peleus's council chamber, hung with purple tapestry and the weapons of former Theban kings. And he was not in the room where we used to play the lyre. The trunk that had once kept our instruments sat forlorn in the room's center. He was not outside either, in the trees he and I had climbed, or by the sea, on the jutting rocks where he waited for his mother, nor on the practice field where men sweated through drills, clacking their wooden swords. I do not need to say that my panic swelled, that it became a live thing, slippery and deaf to reason. My steps grew hurried. The kitchen, the basement, the storerooms with their amp array of oil and wine, and I still did not find him. It was midday when I sought out Peleus's room. It was a sign of the size of my unease that I went at all. I had never spoken to the old man alone before. The guards outside stopped me when I tried to enter. The king was at rest, they said. He was alone and would see no one. But is Achilles? I gulped, trying not to make a spectacle of myself, to feed the curiosity I saw in their eyes. Is the prince with him? He is alone, one of them repeated. I went to Phoenix next. The old counselor who had looked after Achilles when he was a boy. I was almost choking with fear as I walked to his stateroom, a modest square chamber at the palace's heart. He had clay tablets in front of him, and on them the men's marks from the night before, angular and crisscrossing, pledging their arms to the war against Troy. "The Prince Achilles," I said. I spoke haltingly, my voice thick with panic. I cannot find him. He looked up with some surprise. He had not heard me come into the room. His hearing was poor, and his eyes, when they met mine, were rheumy and opaque with cataract. Peleus did not tell you then. His voice was soft. No. My tongue was like a stone in my mouth, so big I could barely speak around it. "I'm sorry," he said kindly. "His mother has him. She took him last night as he was sleeping. They are gone, no one knows where." Later, I would see the red marks where my nails had dug through my palms. No one knows where. To Olympus, perhaps, where I could never follow. To Africa or India. To some village where I would not think to look. Phoenix's gentle hands guided me back to my room. My mind twisted desperately from thought to thought. I would return to Chiron and seek counsel. I would walk the countryside, calling his name. She must have drugged him or tricked him. He would not have gone willingly. As I huddled in our empty room, I imagined it, the goddess leaning over us, cold and white beside the warmth of our sleeping bodies. Her fingernails prick into his skin as she lifts him. Her neck is silvery in the window's moonlight. His body lolls on her shoulder, sleeping or spelled. She carries him from me as a soldier might carry a corpse. She is strong. It takes only one of her hands to keep him from falling. I did not wonder why she had taken him. I knew. She had wanted to separate us. The first chance she had. As soon as we were out of the mountains, I was angry at how foolish we had been. Of course she would do this. Why had I thought that we would be safe? That Chiron's protection would extend here, where it never had before. She would take him to the caves of the sea and teach him content for mortals. She would feed him with the food of the gods and burn his human blood from his veins. She would shape him into a figure meant to be painted on vases, to be sung of in songs, to fight against Troy. I imagined him in black armor, a dark helmet that left him nothing but eyes, bronze greaves that covered his feet. He stands with a spear in each hand and does not know me. Time folded in on itself, closed over me, buried me. Outside my window, the moon moved through her shapes and came up full again. I slept little and ate less. Grief pinned me to the bed like an anchor. It was only my pricking memory of Chiron that finally drove me forth. You do not give up so easily as you once did. I went to Peleus. I knelt before him on a wool rug, woven bright with purple. He started to speak, but I was too quick for him. One of my hands went to clasp his knees, the other reached upwards to seize his chin with my hand. The pose of supplication. It was a gesture I had seen many times, but had never made myself. I was under his protection now. He was bound to treat me fairly by the law of the gods. "Tell me where he is," I said. He did not move. I could hear the muffled batter of his heart against his chest. I had not realized how intimate supplication was, how closely we would be pressed. His ribs were sharp beneath my cheek. The skin of his legs was soft and thin with age. "I do not know," he said, and the words echoed down the chamber, stirring the guards. I felt their eyes on my back. Suppliants were rare in Thea. Peleus was too good a king for such desperate measures. I pulled at his chin, tugging his face to mine. He did not resist. "I do not believe you," I said. A moment passed. "Leave us," he said. The words were for the guards. They shuffled their feet but obeyed. We were alone. He leaned forward, down to my ear. He whispered, "Skyros, a place, an island, Achilles." When I stood, my knees ached, as if I had been kneeling a long time. Perhaps I had. I do not know how many moments passed between us in that long hall of Thean kings. Our eyes were level now, but he would not meet my gaze. He had answered me because he was a pious man, because I had asked him as a suppliant, because the gods demanded it. He would not have otherwise. There was a dullness in the air between us, and something heavy like anger. "I will need money," I told him. I do not know where these words came from. I had never spoken so before to anyone, but I had nothing left to lose. Speak to Phoenix. He will give it to you. I nodded my head barely. I should have done much more. I should have knelt again and thanked him, rubbed my forehead on his expensive rug. I didn't. Peleus moved to stare out the open window. The sea was hidden by the house's curve, but we could both hear it, the distant hiss of waves against sand. You may go, he told me. He meant it to be cold, I think, and dismissive, a displeased king to his subject, but all I heard was his weariness. I nodded once more and left. The gold that Phoenix gave me would have carried me to Skyros and back twice over. The ship's captain stared when I handed it to him. I saw his eyes flicking over it, weighing its worth, counting what it could buy him. You will take me? My eagerness displeased him. He did not like to see desperation in those who sought passage. Haste in a free hand spoke of hidden crimes. But the gold was too much for him to object. He made a noise, grudging, of acceptance, and sent me to my berth. I had never been at sea before and was surprised at how slow it was. The boat was a big-bellied trader, making its lazy rounds of the islands, sharing the fleece, oil, and carved furniture of the mainland with the more isolated kingdom. Every night we put in at a different port to refill our water pots and unload our stores. During the days I stood at the ship's prow, watching the waves fall away from our black tarred hull, waiting for the sight of land. At another time I would have been enchanted with it all, the names of the ship's parts, halyard, mast, stern, the color of the water, the scrubbed clean smell of the winds. But I barely noticed these things. I thought only of the small island flung out somewhere in front of me, and the fair-haired boy I hoped I would find there. The Bay of Skyros was so small that I did not see it until we had swung around the rocky island's southern rim, and were almost upon it. Our ship narrowly squeezed between its extending arms, and the sailors leaned over the sides to watch the rock slide by, holding their breath. Once we were inside, the water was utterly calm, and the men had to row us the rest of the way. The confines were difficult to maneuver. I did not envy the captain's voyage out. We are here, he told me, sullenly. I was already walking for the gangway. The cliff face rose sharply in front of me. There was a path of steps carved into the rock, coiling up to the palace. And I took them. At their top were scrubby trees and goats, and the palace, modest and dull, made half from stone and half from wood. If it had not been the only building in sight, I might not have known it for the king's home. I went to the door and entered. The hall was narrow and dim, the air dingy with the smell of old dinners. At the far end, two thrones sat empty. A few guards idled at tables, dicing. They looked up. Well? One asked me. I am here to see King Lycomedes, I said. I lifted my chin so they would know I was a man of some importance. I had worn the finest tunic I could find, one of Achilles's. I'll go, another one said to his fellows. He dropped his dice with a clatter and slumped out of the hall. Peleus would have never allowed such disaffection. He kept his men well and expected much from them in return. Everything about the room seemed threadbare and gray. The man reappeared. Come, he said. I followed him, and my heart picked up. I had thought long about what I would say. I was ready. In here, he gestured to an open door. Then turned to go back to his dice. I stepped through the doorway. Inside, seated before the wispy remains of a fire, sat a young woman. "I am the Princess Deidamia," she announced. Her voice was bright and almost childishly loud, startling after the dullness of the hall. She had a tipped-up nose and a sharp face like a fox. She was pretty, and she knew it. I summoned my manners and bowed. "I am a stranger, come for a kindness from your father." "Why not a kindness from me?" she smiled, tilting her head. She was surprisingly small. I guessed she would barely be up to my chest if she stood. "My father is old and ill. You may address your petition to me, and I will answer it." She affected a regal pose, carefully positioned so the window lit her from behind. "I am looking for my friend." "Oh," her eyebrow lifted, "and who is your friend?" "A young man," I said carefully. "I see. We do have some of those here." Her tone was playful, full of itself. Her dark hair fell down her back in thick curls. She tossed her head a little, making it swing, and smiled at me again. "Perhaps you'd like to start with telling me your name?" "Chironides," I said, "son of Chiron." She wrinkled her nose at the name's strangeness. "Chironides? And?" "I am seeking a friend of mine, who would have arrived here perhaps a month ago. He is from Thea." Something flashed in her eyes, or maybe I imagined it did. "And why do you seek him?" she asked. I thought that her tone was not so light as it had been. "I have a message for him." I wished very much that I had been led to the old and ill king rather than her. Her face was like quicksilver, always racing to something new. She unsettled me. "A message," she smiled coyly, tapped her chin with a painted fingertip. "A message for a friend. And why should I tell you if I know this young man or not?" "Because you are a powerful princess and I am your humble suitor." I knelt. This pleased her. "Well, perhaps I do know such a man, and perhaps I do not. I will have to think on it. You will stay for dinner and await my decision. If you are lucky, I may even dance for you, with my women." She cocked her head suddenly. "You have heard of Deidamia's women?" "I'm sorry to say that I have not." She made a mow of displeasure. "All the kings send their daughters here for fostering. Everyone knows that but you." I bowed my head, sorrowfully. "I have spent my time in the mountains and have not seen much of the world." She frowned a little, then flicked her hand at the door. "Till dinner, Chironides." I spent the afternoon in the dusty courtyard grounds. The palace sat on the island's highest point, held up against the blue of the sky, and the view was pretty, despite the shabbiness. As I sat, I tried to remember all that I have heard of Lycomedes. He was known to be kind enough, but a weak king of limited resources. Euboea to the west and Ionia to the east had long eyed his lands. Soon enough, one of them would bring war, despite the inhospitable shoreline. If they heard a woman ruled here, it would be all the sooner. When the sun had set, I returned to the hall. Torches had been lit, but they only seemed to increase the gloom. Deidamia, a gold circlet gleaming in her hair, led an old man into the room. He was hunched over, and so draped with furs that I could not tell where his body began. She settled him on a throne and gestured grandly to a servant. I stood back among the guards and a few other men whose function was not immediately apparent. Counselors? Cousins? They had the same worn appearance as everything else in the room. Only Deidamia seemed to escape it, with her blooming cheeks and glossy hair. So, that was my ASMR video, and I didn't finish the entire chapter because it was longer than that, and I've already spent too much time reading, and this is gonna be pretty long. So yeah, thanks for watching. And tell me if you guys like this kind of video, or if it's trash, because I genuinely want to know. So yeah, bye.